wrote under Article 49, 1F and G of the Constitution, and Section 4, 1A, 3 of the Counter-Trafficking in Persons Act 2010, and all enabling provisions of law. The applicant seeks two prayers. One, that the respondent herein be detained for 10 days to enable the applicant conclude investigations. And number two, that the court issue any further orders that they deem fit to grant. The application is based on 10 grounds set out on the face of the application. And a further affidavit sworn on the 18th of November 2020 by the investigating officer, Chief Inspector Wanga Masake. In the said affidavit, the investigating officer implicated the grounds on the application, the grounds and the supporting affidavit, and submissions by all the parties, and the authorities cited, and the issue for determination is whether the application for pretrial detention is merited. In the case of Sudi Oscar Kipchumba, which was cited by the respondents, the learned judge not attached holding charge to the application. However, while the defense, Mr. Omari, was submitting, he was handed over in court a copy of the intended charge sheet, which was a demonstration that the prosecution had a holding charge, though the same had not been filed. And therefore, this is a distinguishing factor with the Michael Rotich case cited above. In the Oscar Sudi case, the court held that while accepting that the text of Article 49.1F and that the continued detention of the individual without a charge being preferred, whether provisional or otherwise, is inevitable due to existing exceptional circumstances. And two, the state must demonstrate that the continued detention of the individual without charge is the least restrictive action can take in balancing the interests present in a potential criminal trial. And differently put, the state must demonstrate, getting officers admitted, that they had found three children in a rehabilitation agency, and they wish to conduct a DNA analysis in order to assist them get their mothers. The respondents submitted that the children were found in May 2020, and since then, nothing had been done, and therefore, the application was not merited. The applicant did not respond to this rejoinder about the time that the children were found, and if indeed they were found in May, as it appears, then indeed the police must have slept on their job. In my view, however, the taking of the rescue children to hospital and the conduct of DNA on the children and the respondent or any other third party must not necessarily be done while the respondents are in custody. The investigating officer needs only to summon the respondent to the station for the particular purpose. And the same being a scientific process, I do not see how the respondents will interfere with this process. This is a line of investigations that can be accomplished even if the respondents are out of custody, receiving some money. In my view, even if the respondents were to be released, they could not in any way interfere with the processes of verification of the clips, which were from an independent source and not in the custody of the respondents. Third, The investigating officer submitted that the fixed places of abode of the respondents was not known, given by the respondents in this spot. This ground cannot therefore stand without the demonstration that efforts to trace the respondents were made and proved futile. Fourth, the investigating officer submitted that the respondents hold crucial information and give and have the potential to interfere with the investigations considering their position in the hospital. In the case of Michael Juma Oyamo and another portrait is provided to the trial court. I have carefully considered the submissions before me in support of the allegations that the respondents may interfere with the investigations if released on bond. The investigating officer submitted that they intended to use certain documents and records which were held in the hospital, and that if the respondents were released, considering their positions, the respondents were likely to interfere with the records and therefore lose evidence. It is not denied that the second and third respondents have seen CEO and administrator, respectively, at Mama Lucy Hospital, while the position of the first respondent was not clear. The nature of investigations, as indicated by the investigating officer, is such that documentation may be crucial, since the children whom I consider as victims are of tender years and are unable to provide any evidence. And therefore, the fear of interference with records and documents, considering the position of the second and third respondents, is a genuine concern and not mere fears and suspicions. If indeed the children in issue emanated from the hospital as alleged, it would then be sensible to secure such evidence in order to protect the best interests of the victim children. The court therefore finds for this reason alone that the application is not brought in bad faith. Aware of the rights of the arrested persons, including the right to be presumed innocent until proven guilty, I will allow the application by the investigating officer on the following terms: that the respondents be remanded in custody for a further period of 2 days from today to enable the police to conclude investigations, that within this period, the investigating officer may visit the said hospital and collect whatever documents or evidence they require in presence of the respondents, and the case will be mentioned on 23rd November for further directions.